morning we're going to sing us some Jamaican songs. But if we sing them, you got to get out of those seats and you got to dance like you're really from Jamaica. Or your parents were from Jamaica, parents' parents were from Jamaica. But I want you to be true to who you are.
Welcome back one more time to what is now referred to as Off the Cuff. I am your host, Elder Charles P. Akins, Sr. I hope that this podcast, this channel, this episode, this whatever you refer to it as, finds you well, healthy, and in good spirits. I do so sincerely pray that today we are able to reach you, to reach someone. Every time I go into the Word of God and I come to share it, it's because I've learned something, that God has presented something for me to use in my life. And I wish to share that with anyone who is willing to hear, anyone who wants another tool, another piece of information, bit of information that might help them. So all of this is for nothing except the glory, the honor, and the praise of God and the edification of His people. So before we go into the title of today's subject, we're going to go into prayer. And I ask that if you would, you go into prayer with me. And what we ask is that God covers the process. And now, most gracious and eternal Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise for all that you do, you've done, and continue to do. Father, we give you glory for all of those who thought it not robbery to be on this cast, to listen. And we pray that their time is fulfilled, that your Holy Spirit speaks through me. We ask that you would increase and allow me the opportunity to decrease. For the excellency of the word, dear God, the excellency of the power is not in this earthen vessel, your servant, but the power is in you and in your spirit. So I pray that by your spirit, you touch, heal, and deliver in the name of Jesus, and let lives be changed, renewed, strengthened, and drawn closer to you. In Jesus' holy name and matchless name, we pray and we thank you in advance. Amen. Okay, so today's lesson is going to be stay close to the fire. Or get close to the fire. Again, that's stay close to the fire or get close to the fire. Today's topic is going to come from the book of Nehemiah in the Old Testament. Nehemiah is a old school prophet. I don't want to get into all of that though, because I don't like to. It's important for us to know things like he was one of the major prophets in the Word, and what his focus was, which was the rebuilding of Israel. But it takes more time to get into that, and then we have less time to get into the word. So please, if you have some opportunities, go back and read up on Nehemiah, because he's an awesome prophet. And what God was able to do, accomplished through him, is awesome. So it would be great for you to go back and read it. But we're going to go into the second chapter of Nehemiah from verses 11 through 20. And then to include with that, we're going to have Revelations, the second chapter also, verses 1 through 7. Again, that's Nehemiah, the second chapter, the 11th through the 20th verse, and then Revelations, the second chapter also, the first through the seventh verses. So Nehemiah reads as thus in the King James Version. So I came to Jerusalem and was there 3 days. And I arose in the night, I and some few men with me. Neither told I any man what God had put in my heart to do at Jerusalem. Neither was there any beast with me save the beast that I rode upon? And I went out by night by the gate of the valley, even before the dragon well, and to the dung port, and viewed the walls of Jerusalem, which were broken down, and the gates thereof were consumed with fire. Then I went on to the gate of the fountain and to the king's pool, but there was no place for the beast that was under me to pass. Then went I up in the night by the brook and viewed the wall and turned back and entered by the gate of the valley and so returned. And the rulers knew not whither I went or what I did, neither had I yet told it to the Jews, nor to the priests, nor to the nobles, nor to the rulers, nor to the rest that did the work. Then said I unto them, ye see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Come, and let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we may be no more a reproach. Then I told them of the land of my God, which was good upon me, as also the king's words that he had spoken unto me. And they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for this good work. But when Sambalah the Aaronite and Tobiah the servant, the Ammonite, and Jeshem the Arabian heard it, they laughed us to scorn and despised us and said, what is this thing that ye do? Will ye rebel against the king? Then answered I them and said unto them, the God of heaven, he will prosper us. Therefore we his servants will arise and build, but ye have no portion, nor right, nor memorial in Jerusalem. Now we're going to go to Revelations, the second chapter, the first through the seventh verses. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil. And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles, and are not, and hast found them liars. And hast borne, and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored, and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. The word of the Lord is indeed blessed. And again, our title for our subject today is Stay Close to the Fire, or Get Close to the Fire. Now, in Nehemiah's story, we find that the children of Israel have been allowed to return from captivity of 70 years in Babylon. The king heard Nehemiah. Nehemiah spoke to the king on behalf of his people. The king allowed Nehemiah to return. Nehemiah was a cupbearer or armor bearer for the king at the time. So he was responsible. He was basically like an executive assistant to the king, make sure the king had everything he needed, so on and so forth. So he had the king's ear. Even though he was in captivity, he had the king's ear. So let's make this spiritual. Even in dire or adverse circumstances, if you stay close to the fire, that is to say, if you remain obedient to the word of God, if you remain diligent in your relationship with God, he will see you through. And not only will he see you through, but he'll let you be in the midst of those circumstances and prosper you even in those circumstances. What's the word say? But without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them who will diligently seek him. So here we have a prophet in Nehemiah who diligently sought God. And because he diligently sought the Lord, because he remained in place regardless of the circumstances around him, God favored him. And not only did God favor him, but he caused man to favor him also. Rebuilding the wall of Jerusalem is similar to the repentance and revival and rededication that one needs to implement in their lives with God. If we find ourselves in a condition where we've backslid, we've fallen away, or maybe we're not backslidden, but we aren't as devoted to our relationship with God as we should be, this story is a story of a person who remained dedicated to God, and it's an opportunity for us to see that God is always willing to take us back under his covering if we allow him to do so, if we make him sovereign in our lives. I had a discussion earlier this week, and an interesting thing. Everyone refers to God as God because everyone understands him to be Elohim, all-powerful, almighty, all-knowing. So he is God. But the question becomes, is he your Lord also? Is he sovereign in your life? Does he rule and reign in your life? Can you say you are his servant or his child? Many times we get caught up in people rather than God. But how many people out there know, if you really devote your life to your relationship with God, God will allow the Holy Spirit to lead and guide you in everything. He will show you where man errs, and he will prevent you from falling prey to the errors of men. See, we all should find ourselves in church somewhere being fed and all. And so I am for that. I believe we all must put ourselves in that position, because that's the condition that will keep us, that will draw us nearer to God, that will save us, and that will condition us to move toward God when we find ourselves in difficulty. So being born behind enemy lines, being born in a world filled with sin and wanting to live a life of salvation, of sanctification, a holy life, we're faced with a lot of obstacles all the way through life. But God is faithful to keep us, to protect us, and to prosper us through them all, mentally, physically, spiritually, and otherwise, if we remain obedient to him. Oftentimes, though, we end up making people, put them in the place of deity. We need leaders. We must find leaders that we know are led by God. Paul said, and I have to find the scripture, but Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. And the implication behind that scripture is, if you see me at a point where I'm not following Christ, then don't follow me. Don't be foolish enough to put yourself in a condition where you're following behind someone who has stopped following God. If someone tells you the Lord told them something, then you have to know their life to know that God told them. And you must seek God yourself for confirmation. But the minute they aren't doing what God told them to do, you're freed. No matter what people, if they try to condemn you or anything else, you're freed at that point, because you're supposed to follow them as they follow Christ. As they follow themselves, they can put you in danger, spiritually, mortally, and or otherwise. So we must be careful to follow Christ. Look at the example of Nehemiah. The Lord took Nehemiah out, caused him to survey the land, right? So when he went to survey the land, that is another metaphor for us surveying our spiritual condition. Okay? So Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, the 27th through the 29th verses is talking. It talks about communion, but the point of the scripture is to talk about the condition of someone's heart and relationship to God before they take communion, to make sure that they are in the right condition, to make sure their relationship is okay with God. And in fact, what I'm going to do is I'm going to read down a little further afterwards so that you see why that's the case. So we're going to start from the 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, the 27th verse. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the blood and body of the Lord, or the guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. So what does that mean? What the scripture is saying in that case is, it's saying when we take communion, we are saying that Jesus is Lord over our lives. We believe he was risen from the dead, and we are signifying our baptism into the body by taking communion. Okay? We're saying we believe, we agree, and that we are within the body, that we live an obedient life in Christ Jesus. If we live an unholy life, an unsanctified life, we're saying Christ died for my sins, and I'm showing my appreciation for his death for my sins. We not only show his appreciation by taking communion, but by remaining obedient to the word of God and to the life of Christ. If we live a life of sin and we take communion, we are not obedient to the word of God or to the life of Christ. And so this is why we're drinking and eating unworthily, because we're claiming Christ is Lord over our lives, but Christ isn't, because we're not living a life in Christ. So now we're lying. We must be saved, sanctified, and Holy Spirit filled in order to have communion. Christ must be Lord over your life to take communion, because that's what communion means. It means you acknowledge Christ as Lord of your life. This is why in some churches they don't allow children to take communion. Because first we are to examine ourselves. We are to repent of any and everything we might have done that would separate us from God. Ask him to forgive us so that we are in right place and right condition spiritually to accept the sacrament. It is a holy sacrament. Christ died for our sins. So communion is a holy sacrament, and we are to respect it and appreciate what it signifies. But if we're living a life in sin, if I'm married, if I'm cheating on my wife, and I turn around and take communion, I'm eating and drinking damnation to my soul. If I beat my wife, but I turn around and take communion, and I haven't asked forgiveness and repented and moved away from it, I'm eating and drinking damnation to my soul. If I lie to my wife about my whereabouts and what I'm doing, I am eating and drinking damnation to my soul, because Christ is in fact not the sovereign God and Lord of my life. Satan is. This is something that's off topic, sort of, but it's important that we understand that, because the point is, we must survey ourselves. We must survey our spiritual condition. We must know where we are in Christ. That's the only way we can stay close to the fire or get close to the fire. See, I want to do that, do the metaphor about staying close to the fire, and then I'm going to move on to the staying close to the fire and regardless of circumstances and all. So the metaphor for staying close to the fire is the physical, right? We're talking about the spiritual. Stay close to the fire, meaning stay close in your relationship to God. Seek God morning, noon, and night if you are able, whenever you get a chance. Stay before God. Just like Proverbs says, 3:5-6, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, lean not to thine own understanding, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he'll direct your path. We are to seek God and stay with him. The word tells us also that we are to lay up for ourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and rust do not break in, and where they don't corrupt, rather, and thieves don't break in and steal. So our focus should be on heavenly things. That is what God wants for our life, how God wants us to be, the things God wants us to focus on, how we can be of service to God and to other people. That's what we should be focused on. When we don't do that, we take the focus off of God, and then we put the focus on our life and then on Satan. Lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, or the pride of life. These things become the things that are in charge. And the natural, follow me in the natural sense. When you move away from a fire, let's say we're somewhere like in the Arctic or somewhere where it's really cold. If the fire is the only means of your survival, which God, the Christ Jesus in your life, the Holy Spirit dwelling in you, is the only means of your survival on earth. This world represents darkness, bitter cold. What does bitter cold and darkness represent? Death. Fire represents heat, life, exuberance. If you move away from the fire, what happens when you find yourself far enough away from a fire, or the fire goes out completely? Then you have people trying to huddle together, trying to stay warm, putting body to body, flesh to flesh, in an effort to stay warm. Right? So when you're in that effort to stay warm, body to body, flesh to flesh, in the spiritual sense, you surround yourself with other people who are just as dead in Christ as you are, in a vain, failing attempt. You surround yourselves with other people. That's why misery loves, hallelujah, thank you Lord, thank you Holy Spirit, that's why misery loves company. I've always, we've heard that thousands of times, right? Misery loves company, misery loves company, misery loves company. I'm dying, but I don't want to die alone. Nobody wants to die alone. They show you in movies all the time, someone is laying somewhere and someone says, I'm going to go get you help. And the person knows they're getting ready to die. What do they say? Don't leave me. I don't want to die alone. It's the selfishness of men that makes us want people to die in sin with us. Instead of saying, if I'm not smart enough to serve God, don't be like me. Have enough sense. You know the way. Bringing all of this back to say, I want y'all to think about that. Think about, just remember that. So the further you move away from the fire, or if the fire goes out, the closer you are to death. And then you huddle up with other people who are dying just like you are. And you're just waiting to die. You're going to die together, but you're waiting to die. That's not a big consolation. So Nehemiah stayed close. No matter what was going on with the children of Israel, they were in captivity. And instead of him having a pity party and all the rest, he stayed close to God. And because he did that, he understood that his faith lied in God and that he had to trust God for everything. So we must endure our circumstances by faith. Life isn't always going to be a bowl of cherries. You're not going to get everything you want. But the worst thing you can do when times get rough is move away from the fire. That is the worst thing you can do. Because the further you are away from the fire, the closer you are to death. Stay near the fire. Stay near the heat. If you moved away from the fire, if you can still see the flames, get back to the fire. Come back to life. For the wages of sin is death. Romans 6:23. But the gift of God, the fire of God, brings eternal life. Get back to the fire, saints, people. Satan seeks to destroy us. Everything he is about destroying us. So again, Satan wants to motivate you to move away from the fire. Right? Because you're embarrassed about what you did. You're embarrassed about how you're living. You don't have strength to fight against it. So now you're embarrassed. Now you're condemned. And what does condemnation do? Condemnation forces isolation. As you feel condemned, you want to get away from people because you want the light to be off of you. You don't want the attention to be on you and your failure, which is shame. You feel shameful about having failed, having gone back. You want to avoid any possible light on the circumstances, so you seek out darkness. We just talked about what happens when you move away from the fire. You become isolated. If you're out there by yourself, you don't even have a person to help keep you warm. And people can only help you stay warm for so long anyway. Then you feel condemned, so you won't ask for forgiveness because you feel condemned. Oh, there's no point in it. I'm too awful. God is not going to hear me. He doesn't want to, blah, blah, blah. You're ashamed. You don't want to go to anybody and tell them what you've done so they can help you. So you retreat to darkness. And as you retreat to darkness, desolation, despair, and everything else takes over. And the next thing you know, you're not looking for God at all. You're looking for ways to silence all of the death that is occurring in your life. So you go to alcohol, drugs, sexual promiscuity, and any other thing that can quiet the deafening sound of all of the spiritual death you're experiencing. Only God will help us, deliver us, and strengthen us. Satan's not going to do that. Again, we went through these steps. Satan is going to be the one that gets you to go fall back and do that, to move away from the light. And then when you get so far away from the light that you can only see a flicker, Satan's going to tell you, you're so stupid for moving away. You had help. You had people who loved you. And now you can't even get back to them because you're so messed up. You're so messed up, nobody wants to help you anymore. Nobody cares about you. Nobody even remembers. And now you're stuck. You deserve to be here. You don't deserve salvation. You deserve to die. And you start believing it. You start believing you don't deserve salvation. You don't deserve to be back. God will never forgive you. All the people, nobody is going to. And who cares? If people don't forgive you anyway, who cares? They don't have a heaven or hell to put you in. The word says, fear not the man who can destroy the body, but fear the one who can destroy the body and the spirit. That's the one you need to fear. Satan can't destroy your spirit. He can only destroy your body. But God can destroy it all. That's who we need to reverence. That's who we need to respect. And no, he doesn't want to destroy it. He wants to give you life. He said, Satan came but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I came that you might have life, and that more abundantly. God wants you to have an abundant life, not one filled with death. He wants you to be at the fire, not away from the fire. He wants you to be heated and hot, not stone cold and dead. Nehemiah knew that God would be with him and had been with him through his trials and tribulations. Him being a cupbearer for the king, he saw God's will on his life there. And he saw God carry him through the whole time of the exile. And even though all that was the case, he was still living well, because he surrendered to God. The objective of Satan will always be to keep us in darkness. But Romans 8 and 1 tells us, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. What do I mean in that? I mean, we go back to Romans 12. You all know I say this scripture all the time because it's imperative. That there's certain scriptures we have to remember and think about all the time. Be ye therefore, I say unto you, my brethren, be therefore not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And be ye transformed. Present your bodies as a living sacrifice. That's the first part. I'm sorry. Present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be ye not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. That's what it is. So it's presenting our bodies first, and then after we present our bodies to God, then we allow Christ into our mind. There's another scripture that says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that would exalt itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought into the obedience of Christ. And then Galatians 2, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ that liveth in me. And this life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. But I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness is come by the law, by good deeds, then Christ is dead in vain. Righteousness is come by our faith in Jesus Christ and our obedience to him because of our relationship and our trust in him, not because we dot every I and cross every T. If we don't dot the I's and cross the T's with the right intentions, God isn't going to care about anything we did. There's going to be a lot of good people who don't make it to heaven. So I just want to say to us today as I close, if you're at the fire, stay close to the fire. If you're not, get close to the fire. As long as you can see the flames, the embers glowing, bring yourself back to the fire. Whoever you are, wherever you are, whatever you've done, it doesn't matter. God will forgive you. He is faithful and just to forgive us. But you've got to let him. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven. I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land. You have to make the choice to come to God and let him do the rest. Now, let's go into prayer. And now, most gracious and most eternal Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we glorify your holy name. We thank you once again for all that you've done, you do, and continue to do. Father, we pray that if there be any in the name of Jesus who desires to come back to you, dear God, we ask that you give them the opportunity, touch their hearts, touch their minds, strengthen them, and encourage them to do so. Help them to come close to the fire. Help them to avoid the darkness. Help them to run to the light, into the marvelous light. Help them, dear God, to receive the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, I have sinned against thee, and against thee only have I sinned. I pray that you forgive me for anything that I have said, done, thought, or felt that could separate me from you and from your love. God, I confess that Christ Jesus, he is Lord, and I believe in my heart that you raised him from the dead, and I receive him in my heart today. I thank you, I praise you, I receive your Holy Spirit and your touch. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. I pray that something was said to encourage you. I pray that God is exalted in your lives. Be healthy. Be safe. God love you. And until we meet again, be well.
Well, then we're going to sing us some Jamaican songs. But if we sing them, you got to get out of those seats and you got to dance like you're really from Jamaica. Or your parents were from Jamaica, parents' parents were from Jamaica. But I want you to be true to who you are. number. Everybody sing it.